I have to speak not my own language, and you do too, so maybe that will help us. So what I want to speak with you about, as I was asked to do actually, was about the philosophy of artifacts, the philosophy of things, and how it has developed in the Netherlands, and especially in the work that we are doing in Twente. So I want to take you on a tour through technological things, how to understand the relations between humans and technological artifacts. Basically, that is a question that is a very fundamental question, you could say, within the history of philosophy also. Because if there's one basic distinction that we have always made in our thinking, it's the distinction between subjects and objects. And we make it in many, many ways. And it's a distinction you can hardly get around. There is this big difference between humans and other entities. Humans have freedom, have intentions, can be held responsible for what they do, things. Objects cannot. They are dead, mute, silent. They don't do anything. You cannot blame a car for a car accident or whatever. It's humans who have the own responsibility, the freedom, the intentions. So it's hard to understand the interactions between the two, but still there are many interactions. Because only already if you look at that picture and the ways in which those cell phones were designed, it's a very old picture already, anticipates a lot of humanity in it. Its size, the ways in which you can operate it. It will also have a lot of impact on the lives that people live when they have a cell phone. And on the other hand, the ways in which those human beings are there is deeply influenced by the technologies that they use. And they are not naked, they wear clothes. Some of them is looking actually on a mobile phone probably. So there is a close link between the two. So how to understand the relations between humans and and things? Is there a gap? Or should we somehow blur the boundaries between the two? Well, in the Netherlands, there have been two approaches to this problem. The Twente approach, that's the approach that I'm working on with many other people in Twente. The Delft approach comes from analytic philosophy and has been working for a long time on what they call the dual nature of technological artifacts. It's basically the same intuition. Any technology has these two dimensions. On the one hand, they're physical. They're material things, a physical kind of structure that has a specific operability. You can touch it. It has some kind of material properties. On the other hand, it's social. They bear the intentions of their designers, and they are used by human beings because of the physical properties they have. So they have this dual nature. Like light has a dual nature, wave and particle. Artifacts have a dual nature of physical and social. So how to understand it? So they made a lot of theories in which the concept of function plays a central role. And because a function is, of course, specifically that place where the material structure and the human intention come together. A function is the outcome of an interaction between humans and things, you could say. In Twente, we have been working for quite some time now on what we have come to call the mediation approach. And this has its background in phenomenology, which we try to give some kind of an update, if I may say, into post, it's not the best word you could imagine, post-phenomenology, but still it's an attempt to move beyond the limitations of the older versions of phenomenology and try to, come to an approach to technological artifacts that help us to understand how they play a relation, a role in the interactions and in the relation between human beings and their world. And of course, phenomenology has always been fighting against that subject-object distinction, as if the world would indeed consist of the two and there would be no way to find a relation between them. The whole idea of phenomenology is that the things in themselves, they might exist, but it doesn't make much sense to think about the things in themselves. Because as soon as we think about them, they become the things for us. They're only there in the relations we have with them. And human beings on themselves, they might exist in a sense, but also that doesn't make much sense to think about because we're always somehow directed at the world around us. So we cannot just think, we think something, we see something, we hear something, we feel something. So subject and object do not exist separately. They're always somehow interrelated. And the whole intention of the post-phenomenological approach is to see technologies not as objects over against the human subjects, but as media, as mediators, mediating entities between human beings and their world. So that's what I want to explain to you with some larger movements here. I want to do that in three lines. I'm not sure if we will reach the third. It's kind of an extra if we have enough time, but I think not. So then we will do only the first two. And I try to call them a philosophy of technology, from technology, and for technology. So the philosophy of technology is how to understand technology with philosophical means. But it has started to develop into what I like to call a philosophy from technology, in the sense that we try to come to an approach to technology that doesn't apply pre-given philosophical frameworks to artifacts, but it actually tries to study artifacts and let that be a challenge for philosophical theories. So to do an empirical form of philosophy, not to say that we should do empirical research only or that philosophy is an empirical field, but an empirically informed way of doing philosophy, that's what I want to reach. And if you do that, actually, then technology becomes the starting point of doing a lot of, well, you could say, the older and the more classical philosophical themes in a new way. If you take seriously that technologies are the medium through which we have relation with the world around us, then it also means that you need to understand how technology has an impact on all the aspects of philosophy, like epistemology, knowledge. Scientists study the world with the help of scientific instruments, and those instruments help to shape the character of how they understand the world. Ethics, normative choices and decisions that we make are not being made neutrally, but we make them after being informed by technologies and having options by technologies. So also ethics is mediated by artifacts. And even metaphysics, the most fundamental frameworks with which we think, subject, object, need to be updated or reinterpreted from the perspective of mediation, I think. Having done that, and if there is time, we could also see if we could make this society relevant, if we could actually inform practices of technologists, engineers, designers with those ideas, helping them to design technologies in such a way that they could anticipate the impact that technologies have on society. But let's first start with the idea of the philosophy of technology. So the whole idea of mediation theory in that book, What Things Do, which was already mentioned by Bernadette before the break, the whole idea was that many people started to feel some discomfort with the older views of technology that had been developed in the history of philosophy of technology. So in that book, I mainly tried to analyze Jaspers and Heidegger. They make very interesting and good interpretations, of course, so let there be no mistake about that. But their interpretations are so big, so massive, as it were, that they can hardly do justice, I would say, to the actual technologies we encounter in our everyday lives. So that's what we felt. And what I tried to do is to show that, in fact, the older approach to technologies always tried to reduce them to some kind of system behind it, to the conditions that made the technologies possible. So, for instance, Jaspers had this analysis that technologies made it possible for humans to exist in large numbers on this Earth. So technologies, therefore, brought into existence a system of mass production, of bureaucracy, where the world becomes organized as a functional system, where the individual only can play a role as the fulfiller of a function, etc. And then if he tries to understand a technology, it's always by moving back to the system of mass production behind it. Martin Heidegger, who was thinking was illustrated by those two pictures here, tried to understand technology basically as a technological approach to the world, if I say it in more mundane terms than he himself said it. And so for Heidegger, actually, his most famous example maybe is the example of a dam in the Rhine, a power plant that was built to use the power of the water to generate electricity. And he said, okay, this is a very particular interpretation, actually, of the Rhine as a supplier of energy. You need already to have in place a specific approach to nature as something that's standing reserve at your disposal, that you can do something with it in order to be able to build such a power plant. So the essence of technology for Heidegger is a technological way of thinking. It's not that the power plant makes us see the Rhine as a supplier of energy. It's more we have this way of thinking because of which we can see the Rhine as a supplier of energy, that we came to build a power plant. So from the technologies, they move back to the conditions for the technologies. And what I want to do in that book is to think the other way, to start from technologies and to try to understand how they help to shape relations between human beings and their world. So how our interpretations of the world take shape through the, well, micro level interactions we have with technologies. So that would then be a philosophy of things, maybe. Of course, many people have been trying to think about things. And I think there are three basic models that have been developed to understand the relations between humans and technologies and artifacts. Seeing technologies as extensions, and then they become instrumental. Humans have intentions, and things are the instruments to do those things we want to do. It can be dialectics, kind of a dialogue, an interaction, typically a tension between humans and artifacts. Technologies can be an oppression of society, for instance. I will say more about it later. And third, a hybrid model, where the boundaries between the two become blurry, where it becomes hard to make a sharp distinction between the two. Of course, we need to make a distinction, but a separation appears to be impossible. So we need to rethink the boundaries between the two. So let me say a bit more about each of the three models. So I think Joe Pitt is maybe at this moment one of the most visible scholars who defends the neutrality of technology, who even can get really offended if you want to see more in technology than a neutral means. So he would really say, if you, for instance, want to attribute some kind of a moral significance, an ethical significance to an artifact, then in fact you reduce human responsibility. That indeed, you might want to blame a car for a car accident rather than the person operating that car. Intentions are human, things don't have intentions, there's no way that the technology can ever have the intention to do something, so why think about more than instrumentality if you think about technologies? That's the argument that people give in this approach. Things are tools, they enable us to do something, but in themselves they're neutral. And you can use a hammer to get a nail into the wall, you can use it as a murder weapon. It's not the fault of the hammer, it's the fault of the user using that hammer. The complete opposite is actually an approach where technology becomes a serious force in society with which we are in some kind of an interaction. And that's actually the approach that has been followed a lot in German anthropology, philosophical anthropology, where you can see this nice development from Ernst Kapp to Hermann Schmidt to Arnold Gehlen, where you see technologies in relation to even the human organism. For Kapp, actually, technological artifacts should be seen as some form of projections, maybe it has been said here before already during this week, of the human organs. So a hammer is actually a fist, but then made into matter. Or a saw is modeled after our teeth, right? And the system of wires through which we make phone calls, etc., is modeled after our nerve system. So the idea is that we externalize ourselves. Our own subjectivity becomes externalized in the objective world, and then there can be an interaction or even a clash between the two. Schmidt even said that we also externalize things we can do. He sees a development from tools to machines to automatic machines, where tools need to be operated both mentally and physically by the humans. The machine does the physical part, but the human needs to do the mental part, and the automatic machine does both at the same time. So we externalize also things that we can do. And then Gehlen tried to understand that if we have all those devices, artifacts in place, then there are all kinds of relations between our organism and those devices. They can be extensions of us, they can be forms of replacement of us, they can strengthen things that we have. So then suddenly you see a dialectics between the subject and the externalizations of the subject in the object. And we learn to know ourselves and more about ourselves because of our interaction with the things that we made out of ourselves. They're like a mirror. But you see that dialectical model also in a phenomenological approach and also in current views in ethics, actually, where there's often a theme of a tension between humans and technologies. So the older phenomenology, Jaspers and Heidegger, those people were really negative about technologies. They felt that it was a threatening force to our culture, to our society. Technology becomes an autonomous system, in a sense. the neutral means have become an end in themselves. There is no escape anymore. There are so many people living on this earth that we have become somehow addicted to technology. There is no other way to organize our world than as one big machine, otherwise we could never survive. Or for Heidegger, we have this technological approach, this technological way of thinking, and there is no way to get out of that. Because if we want to design a new way of thinking, if we want to think ourselves out of this way of thinking, then that itself would be a technological manipulation. Then we design a new way of thinking. So it would always somehow throw us back into the technological thinking that we have become somehow trapped in. So there's a fight between the two. And the only thing we can do for Heidegger is to hope that there might be a new way of understanding, but we can never enforce it upon ourselves, because that would remain within the realm of technological thinking. In applied ethics, you basically see the same. There are some kind of human values that we want to somehow safeguard or protect against technology. So the basic model is a fight, a struggle between humans and technologies, and ethical norms need to be in place to somehow be a boundary guard, a border guard between the subject and the object, the humans and the technology. That's a dialectical model in many forms. Then the hybrid model actually tries to thematize the interaction between humans and technologies as so fundamental and so deep that it becomes hard even to make a sharp distinction between the two. And you could say, with the words of Karen Barad, that it moves from interaction to intra-action, in the sense that an interaction presupposes that first you have a human being, a technological artifact, and then there's an interaction between the two. But intra-action would say that from this interaction, it somehow emerges what that human being is and what the world is for that human being. An example that I will give later that I like to use in the context is to make a sonogram of an unborn child when you're pregnant. A completely new phenomenon. Yeah, you could say that actually the unborn child has become a new entity for us since we have sonograms. It's not that, of course, there is a fetus and of course there is an expecting couple. But you should not see it as there's the fetus and the couple and then there's a sonogram and then suddenly it's a new link between the two. Because the fetus, what the fetus is for us now, has changed forever because of the sonograms we have. So the kind of reality the fetus has and what it means to expect a child has changed. It's the outcome of the interaction rather than the starting point of it, you could say. That's intra-action. And if you look at it from that perspective, then the interactions are very close and it becomes hard to make a sharp separation between the two. And this is exactly the discussion that I like to have with people in actor network theory, Latour and his colleagues. Because there's a big difference between, I think, what we try to do in our mediation approach and what actor network theory tries to do. It's similar, but also really different. In actor network theory, it's about associations of entities, actants. And the main category is action, which I think means basically something like having an impact, making a change. And it doesn't matter if those entities in those interactions are human or non-human, anything that has an impact is an agent, is an actant. So in post-phenomenology, what we try to do is actually to not to separate subject and object, human and technology, but to make a distinction between them, recognizing that they can never be separated. They're always related, but their roles are different. You can look, as it were, from the perspective of the human. You can try to see how technologies, for instance, shape interpretations, ways of understanding the world. And that's a category that you could hardly apply to things. Things are involved in our interpretations, sure. So you cannot separate the two. They are in our interpretations. But you can only use that word if you have some kind of a distinction between subject and object, human and non-human. So that's the basic distinction. So then, what does that mediation idea entail? Well, basically, the intuition is very, very basic. Bonnide has developed this basic intuition already in the 1970s, an American philosopher of technology, one of my major sources of inspiration. Bonnide tried to move beyond that, beyond the way in which phenomenology tried to overcome the subject-object distinction. And so phenomenology has always said you cannot understand the humans without their relations to the world, and the world without humans having a relation with them. But then the approach became, okay, and technologies actually become some kind of an obstacle. So they alienate the two from each other. So Heidegger said, no, if you look carefully at how we deal with technologies, they're rather a way to get access to the world. If you read an MRI image, it's not an alienation from the brain. It's a new way of making the brain real. It's a new way of understanding psychological disorders, human behavior. It's a new way of getting access to the world. Not per definition a better way, but a new way. It's not an alienation, it's a new form of engagement. Technologies are the media through which we have relations with the world around us. So what I try to do with that basic idea is to give it two dimensions. And you can ask yourself how human beings are there in their world through technologies, how the world can be there for human beings through technologies. So how we live our lives, how we act, how we are engaged in all kinds of ways of living, doing things, practices. And you can try to understand how the world can be there for us, how we perceive the world, how we interpret the world, have experiences. Technologies are there, always, in shaping the relations between humans and world. They help to shape practices and experiences. That's the basic intuition of post-phenomenology. And doing this, then, has a lot of implications for many subfields of philosophy. For epistemology, as I said in the beginning, scientists studying the world with the help of instruments. What do those instruments do to the ways in which they understand the world? Human beings making a decision about the lives of the unborn child, mediated by ultrasound. What does ultrasound do to the ways in which they make decisions? So there is an epistemological charge or an ethical charge somewhere in the technology. They don't do ethics by themselves, they don't do epistemology by themselves, of course. But we do ethics and epistemology, etc., in a different way, because technologies help us to have a relation with the world around us in which we act, in which we perceive, in which we understand things. So what Don Eide did was also to zoom in more detail on this human-technology world relation, because there are many forms that relation can have. So in Eide's work, it looks like this. He says there are four kinds of relations that we can have with technologies. We can embody them. They become part of us, as it were. You could say kind of an extension of the human being. A pair of glasses, you don't look at them, through them to the world. That's what we do. And then the idea is humans and technologies form this unity, and that has a direction, an intentionality, an intentional relation with the world. We can also actually read a technology. A thermometer doesn't give us a sensation of a temperature, but it gives us a number that we need to interpret in order to understand whether it's cold or warm outside, or whether somebody has a fever or not. Right? So that's, with a big word, a hermeneutic relation. It's an interpretive relation. Technologies help us to interpret the world around us. The artifacts become some kind of a unity with the world, and we are directed at the way in which the artifact gives us a representation of the world. And third, we can also interact with the technology, with a robot or with an ATM. And there, the world is not that much of value in a sense, or not of value, but of relevance. And we interact with the technology and the world behind it. For now, we can leave that behind. And then fourth, there is also another type of relation with technologies where technologies become the background of our lives. So we are not explicitly directed at the technologies or via the technologies at the world, but they form the context of our experiences. And the fact that there is light here, that it's not too warm, not too cold, that you hear the sound of the beamer, etc. It all helps to shape your experience of me and my experience of you. It helps to shape how loud I need to speak, etc. It's contextual. It mediates our interaction, but in a contextual way. So this has worked for a long time, and I think many people now are trying to expand this scheme. This is also one of the discussions taking place now in this group of people thinking about mediation, whether we need to do this. And we do not always have the same ideas about this. Don Eide himself thinks that this actually is all. We don't need more than this. But there are more people now who start to think that maybe we need to expand it a bit. So what you can say is that in this scheme, technologies move ever further away from the human, you could say, from being embodied to being read to being interacted with to becoming the background. So at the extremes, there might be more space. technologies can also be more intimate than embodied, or more interactive than just a background. So for instance, an implant in the brain, which is used, for instance, at the moment quite a lot for people with all kinds of diseases in the brain, Parkinson's disease, for instance, serious other disorders in psychiatry. Deep brain stimulation is not like a thing that you wear, you put it on, you put it off again. It's really a physical intervention in how your brain functions. And people sometimes also experience a change in their own, well, way of feeling, seeing, perceiving, in their moods, in their personality maybe even. So you could say it's more intimate than an embodiment relation. It's like a fusion, and you become a hybrid with the technology. Smart environments shape backgrounds which are different than just the sound of the beamer and the light and the temperature here, because they're interactive. So the example that you see there is an example, it's a very old one. It's a persuasive, it's a mirror. It was designed for the waiting room of medical doctors. Maybe you've seen it or heard of it before. The idea is that it's actually a screen with a camera, and it's linked to your patient record. So it sees you, recognizes your face, and knows that you smoke, for instance, or that you eat too much. And then it morphs your face within 1 second into what you would look like in 5 years' time if you would not give up smoking or if you would stay eating too much. And the idea is that you suddenly would think, oh my God, is this what's going to happen to me? So what kind of relation do we have with that? I think the background relation is not enough to characterize what's at stake there, right? There is some kind of a interaction. So the technology merges with the world. It becomes our world in that sense. And we are somehow, you could say, immersed in that world. So you could say that Donaidy mainly speaks about technology that we use. But the configuration of use is not the only configuration we have. We also have a configuration of fusion, of immersion. I'll skip one example for the reason of time. You could say maybe it even goes further. For instance, if you can really make choices about our biological constitution, that might be even more intimate in a sense. So at the moment I'm studying a technology that's being done at the University of Twente where I work, where people work on lab on a chip, and they are designing now a technology to separate sperm cells with X and Y chromosomes. They made a test for men to test at home how good their sperm is. And when they had that test, they thought, okay, now we have that. So, I mean, people need that because we get kids ever later in our lives, and then it becomes hard to become pregnant, and then you need to know if it's because of him or her. So you can test this at home with a very cheap test that they made. But it's nanotechnology, so it's tiny little chips. And a sperm cell is a huge thing on the nanoscale. So they can actually count them one by one and manipulate them one by one. And then they thought, okay, X chromosomes are a bit longer, a bit heavier than Y chromosomes. So there's a clear difference between the two, and you can have them one by one on this chip. So why not send the boys left and the girls right, as it were, the boys to be and the girls to be. So that's what they did. And they're working on it now. It's quite far, and they use it especially for animals, for chicken, for instance, and that can be very important. I'm not sure how it works here, but in the Netherlands we kill every day a lot of animals that cannot give us eggs. So only the hens will survive when the roosters will be killed in their first hours already, because we cannot use them. Well, they will not even be born anymore if we have this chip. But if it would enter society for human beings, what would that imply? Well, it's a radical new way of, well, taking responsibility for ourselves and having a relation to ourselves with technologies, I would say. And there are also technologies that give us some kind of an expansion of a repertoire of perception, like Google Glass or other technologies like that, which gives us some kind of an augmentation. Google Glass, a wearable internet screen with a camera, and you see the world through glass, and you have this extra information about the world on the screen. You have kind of a bifurcation, two worlds at the same time, in a sense. I would also say that that's a new kind of relation we have with the world. So you can toy with this idea. The main message is mediation thinking means that we try to see technologies not as objects over against subjects, but as media through which humans are in their world, through which we experience the world, through which we act. Okay, we will definitely not reach three, but we will do two. I still have 15 minutes, I think. Yeah. Okay, so what does this imply then? And so now we have this idea of mediation and we can use it to study technologies, to analyze what technologies do. And now I want to show what this could mean if you try to do a philosophy from technology. So if you try to study technologies and see what they imply for the ways in which we do philosophy. And let me start by discussing some examples in the field of ethics, because the text that I asked you to read is also about that discussion. And let's see if we can also pay attention to the other two. So let me just give you a few examples of normative technologies, very mundane things, so not deep philosophy, definitely not deep ethical theory. There can be norms in technologies, I would say, like in this technology. You have them here probably as well in France. So you go to the supermarket, you get your stuff, and in the old days you could just leave your cart behind on the parking place or near your bikes in the Netherlands. But now we actually have this coin lock, and it embodies a clear norm: return me to the place where you got it. Okay, is this ethics? Do human beings make decisions together with the technology? Yes, I think. I don't think that this coin lock makes a decision in itself, but it embodies some kind of norm. And the norm can be in your ideas, in your head, but the norm can also be materially installed somehow. It does play a role in our normative choices. Same holds true for values. At our university 15 years ago, we had an exposition about sexist objects. And this is one of them, actually. It's interesting. Actually, our own Dutch company, Philips, is very good at sexist objects, it appeared. if you own this device as a lady and it stops functioning, there is no way to do something about that. You cannot open it. You cannot clean it. You cannot repair it. If it stops functioning, you have to somehow throw it away, buy a new one. There's no screw. It's melted, as it were. You cannot open it. It's a one-time thing. As a man, of course, you get this exploded view with your razor. And the expensive models even give you a tiny little box with a screwdriver and a little brush to open it. And so there's a different idea about masculinity and femininity, values about human beings in a material infrastructure. But this is still, I mean, could you say that this urges us to think about things in terms of ethics? Maybe a bit. It becomes more interesting if the examples go deeper. And this is one of my favorite examples, the pill, the anticonceptive pill. Anne Rimol, Dutch philosopher, anthropologist, made a very nice analysis of the role of the pill in the emancipation movements, in the liberation movements. So she gave this talk actually in Twente a long time ago already, and everybody thought, oh, this is going to be a boring talk. We know that story. The pill played a huge role in the emancipation of women, because now women have more control about reproduction, and the average number of kids went down from 3.6 to 1.4 or something. Their income went up. If you see all the figures, of course, the pill made a difference for women. But her story was not about women. It was about homosexuals. So she claimed that the most central role that the pill played was in our ethical views on homosexuality. Because if you look at the numbers and the figures in that kind of discussion, you also see a sharp change as soon as the pill was introduced on a large scale. So how can you understand that? Well, she nicely showed that in ethical discussions about homosexuality, it had always been a self-evident background that sex was to get a child. It was always linked. There was no really very reliable way to somehow prevent that you would get a child from having sex. And in that context, it's weird, strange, dirty, not supposed to be there if you have sex with somebody of the same sex, because you can never get a child. So it was self-evident that this is not how it is supposed to be, because sex is to get a child. But now that we have this pill, actually it changed all the way down, because when we have sex because we like it, and at some point we want to have a child, we stop taking the pill. So there is a sharp distinction now between sexuality and getting a child. And against that background, it's much more easy to be in favor of homosexuality. It's not that weird. If you love somebody, you can have sex. Having a child is a separate thing. Very interesting. And if you see how the discussion went, you see a very nice link between the two. Of course, the pill didn't force us to have another idea about homosexuality or something, but it definitely changed the context within which we have moral views. So that's quite a thing. The pill changing our ethical frameworks. That's kind of an insult for people who believe in the autonomy of the human subject and in the autonomy of the ethical subject. Apparently, our normative views are also technologically mediated. Well, you can take it one step further. One pill was not taken, and then you end up here. I gave you the example already. And ultrasound also, of course, plays a big role in ethical decisions. Not that it somehow asks us to have an abortion if we see that there is some kind of a defect in the unborn child or something, but it makes us suddenly responsible for things that used to be fate. Suddenly we can now see the unborn, and it makes a lot of translations. Suddenly the woman becomes the environment for the fetus, as it were. In the old days, you would ask a woman what she would feel, how she felt. You would feel through her belly, listen through her belly. Now suddenly she's on the table, as it were, and you look at the screen. So there's a separation between the two. And there's, of course, all those medical norms that help us to interpret the fetus now. The thickness in the nape of the neck indicating the risk of Down syndrome, etc. So it's a medicalization of the fetus, and therefore expecting a child becomes more choosing a child, also after the conception. So ultrasound doesn't steer our ethical decisions, but it shapes how we ask ethical questions and also how we could answer them. What does that imply for ethics? Should this be a reason to change our views on ethics? And should we do a philosophy from technology here? Should these technologies be a reason to change the way in which we see ethics? Yes, I think so. In a modest way. Because, of course, if you believe in this modernistic idea that ethics can only be a human thing, then it feels like an insult. And that you should take seriously that technologies, things, play a role in our ethical decisions. But of course, it depends on how you see that. So if you say, okay, there's an autonomous human subject and there can never be any interference from a technological device in the thinking of the subject, yeah, then it becomes hard. And that's also what people actually say, which I like to call, with a nod to Foucault, some kind of blackmail of humanism. So if you try to make room for technological mediation and ethics, and people say, ah, so you want to blame cars for car accidents, and you want to take away the responsibility from the humans and say it's all the technology's fault. So people feel that this is actually kind of a slippery slope where you take away the most central, important thing that we have in ethics, human responsibility. I feel actually that you could also see this a bit differently. Maybe it's some kind of a narcissistic offense in a sense. It's hard for us to make room for the idea that we might not be as big and important as we thought that we were. But in fact, it makes us more responsible than less responsible. Because we now, in fact, also become responsible for the design of the technologies that have this impact on our normative frameworks. It shouldn't imply that we just give over, hand over the control to all the devices, and we cannot do anything, we are just the slaves of technologies. Of course not. That would only be the case if you would think that it's a choice between subject and object. So either in the subject or in the object is the ethics. But the ethics actually is in the interactions between the two. You can nicely illustrate that, I think, by going through other approaches to this moral significance of technological artifacts, because there are more of them. Langner Winner, for instance, maybe some of you have heard the example. I'm not sure if the example came on the table here this week already. Famous example, Langner Winner, over there. A famous example, actually I have a picture of the example, the very low built overpasses over the parkways on Long Island, New York. Actually the picture was taken from the car of Don Idy, who was behind the wheel. We were there and I thought, man, these are the overpasses that Langner Winner is writing about. So they were built so low that only cars can go below them and no buses. And the idea of the architect, Robert Moses, was actually that this should make sure that only people who could afford a car could reach the beaches, which in those days were white people having money and not the black people who had to take the bus. So you could say this is kind of a racist design. That's how Winner tries to frame it. Technologies have politics, therefore. They can even embody quite bad forms of politics. Still, I would say, yeah, is this a moral agent? Well, in fact, in this example, all the agency is still in the human being. The architect installs his racist ideas in a technology, and that does the thing. Latour actually tried to address what he called the missing masters of morality, showing that in speed bumps, etc., there is ethics as well, because a speed bump makes sure that we slow down near a school because there could be a kid on the street, but not because of our conscience, but because of actually we want to not to damage our cars, in a sense. But there is a norm installed in that. So that's kind of a symmetry in the sense that the technology and the humans play some kind of a powerful role in the making of ethical decisions. But there, the specific human role, the interpretive role, the taking responsibility part, the arguments you can have, the reasons for action, do not play such a big role. There are also people who actually try to claim that a technology, just like a human, can do ethics. You can program a computer to make a moral decision. But there, actually, you do the opposite thing. Winner, in fact, puts all the agency in the humans, at least in this example. There are other examples which are much more subtle, actually. And they put all the agency in the technologies. I think they keep reproducing that modernistic idea that it's either the subject or the object. So what I want to do with that mediation idea is to move beyond that idea. No, it's not about moral instruments. No, it's not about artificial agency. It's about moral mediation. Technologies do not do ethics on themselves. So, and this is always what you hear from people who are anxious about this way of thinking. So you want to make the artifacts into agents? No, I don't. I don't think technologies are moral agents. But the bad news is, I don't think humans on themselves are moral agents either. Because we are always agents in the network of relations we have with the world around us. That's the core intuition of phenomenology. And the human-world relation is always mediated by artifacts. By mediating how we do things, how we experience the world, technologies help to shape moral actions and moral decisions. So what does that mean? Again, the narcissistic offense. People can get so mad of this, as I noticed, as you can see in the article that I sent you. I thought that there is more at stake here than just an intellectual discussion. People really feel somehow offended by this idea. Maybe it is a bit like Freud trying to analyze how science can be felt as an offense. So we thought we were the most special creature ever because we have science, and then like a boomerang, it hits back on us. Because suddenly Copernicus starts to show that actually the Earth is going around the Sun rather than the Sun around the Earth. Darwin shows that we are as close to the apes as we could be to God. Freud himself shows that what we call our personality, our ego, is actually only a thin layer of resistance on a very big bowl of stuff that we don't even want to look at. So it makes us smaller and smaller. Maybe technology is the fourth blow to that narcissistic self-image. Our autonomy should be reinterpreted, I think, in terms of trying to develop a free relation to technology. I think making a distinction between autonomy and freedom is essential. Autonomy means isolating you from the powers that are around you. And this is, of course, a fiction. It's also a bit like a straw man, because there are not many people who really believe in that view of autonomy. But I think if we try to expand the words with which we understand moral agency, the moral agent, for instance, intentionality, having the intention to act, then you can say, okay, intendere means to give some kind of a direction. Mediating things give a direction to our experience, to our actions. So in our intentions, there's also this intendere by the technologies. We can see this as a mediated thing. Autonomy is also one of the prerequisites for moral agency. Well, if you see this as seeing how technologies organize how you behave, how you perceive the world, and taking responsibility for that, like a second order form of autonomy, then you can keep up the idea of freedom, but you give up the idea that you're completely autonomous with that narcissistic self-image that people try to defend. And this is, to get back to where we started and to end the talk, also why it's so important to have this asymmetrical approach for me. A full symmetry would make it impossible to see the specific human aspect here, the way in which humans can understand the fact that they are themselves being mediated. if there's just a symmetry, anything that has an impact can go, and there's no way to look below the surface, as it were. With phenomenology, you can do that, actually. And it makes you more responsible, in a sense, than less, because now suddenly you also become responsible for the way in which you let technologies have an impact on you, or the ways in which we design technologies that have an impact on us. So the most important concept for me here to understand this is the concept of the limit attitude by Foucault. And maybe that's the best way to end it. Maybe I should look for that slide that I have of that, and you see everything in very fast order. So Foucault